So in this lecture we shall be starting our discussion on floating point arithmetic. So we have seen earlier how a floating point number can be represented. So now we shall see how with this representation we can carry out addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, and for doing that what kind of hardware is required, okay. So we shall be looking into that. So we start with floating point addition and subtraction. We consider them together because the process is very similar and the same hardware can be used for performing both addition and subtraction. So let us assume that we have two numbers, okay, for the time being we are not showing the sign, sign is also there. So we are showing only the magnitude and the exponent part, m 1 into 2 to the power e 1 and the other number is m 2 into 2 to the power e 2. And we assume that the exponent value of the first number is larger than that of the second, let us say e 1 is greater than e 2. So for addition or subtraction the basic steps will be as follows. So you look, you take the smaller of the smaller exponent. So here I have assumed that the second number has the smaller exponent. So select the number with the smaller exponent, here it is e 2, and shift its mantissa right by e 1 minus e 2 position such that this e 2 becomes equal to e 1. That means you are aligning the mantissa such that the exponents are becoming equal. Suppose this was 2 to the power 10 and this was 2 to the power 5, you shift m 2 by 5 position such that this also becomes 2 to the power 10. So both the exponents will become equal after that. So the result will have an exponent value which will equal to this larger one, because after this I will be adding or subtracting m 1 and m 2 straight away, because m 2 is already shifted, right. So we have already aligned the mantissa. So after shifting, I will take an example to illustrate this. So after shifting we simply carry out addition or subtraction depending on which operation we are trying to carry out, and also we can see the result of addition or subtraction and you can calculate the sign of the result. And after addition or subtraction we may need to normalize the result because the result may not start with a 1. For normalization I have to shift it left so that the first bit of the mantissa always becomes a 1, so that we can represent the mantissa in a suitable way excluding that implied 1, right. Okay. Let us take an example. Suppose we are adding two numbers f 1 and f 2 whose values are 270.75 and 2.375. So 270.75 if you express in binary it becomes this, and in a normalized binary floating point representation you can write it as 1 point, you shift the radix point by 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 positions. So it becomes this multiplied by 2 to the power 8. Similarly, f 2 can be represented in binary as this. So if you shift this point by 1 position, it becomes this. So it becomes 2 to the power 1. Now for the two numbers, one of them is 2 to the power 8, other is 2 to the power 1. Second one is smaller. So what I do? We shift the mantissa of the number with the smaller exponent, that means f 2, by 8 minus 1, 7 positions. So this 10011 we shift right by 7 positions, so it becomes like this. So it was originally starting from here, I shift it right 7 positions, right. After shifting then we add, then we do a bit by bit addition. Well here the bits are not there, assuming to be 0, you add them like this. Now after adding, as you can see that the number of bits in the sum will be much larger. So you take the first 24 bits of the sum, this will be your actual result, right, and this remaining bits will be the residue. So your actual result will be this, where this number is already normalized, it starts with 1, so 1 point this, and 2 to the power, it will be the x, already you have made it 2 to the power 8, right, by shifting by 7 positions into 2 to the power 8. This will be the result. This is how we carry out addition. This is the residue, as I said. Take an example of a subtraction similarly. So, let us take a number 224 and 270.75. 270.75 is like this, you can represent it as follows, and F 2 is 224. So, if you express in normalized form, put the decimal point here, it becomes 2 to the power 7, because you have to shift the decimal point by 7 positions. So, similarly, you will have to shift the mantissa of F 2 by 1 position, because this is 2 to the power 8, it is 2 to the power 7. So, by 1 position, so shift it right by 1 position, 1 1 1 and 5 zeros. You subtract, do a bit by bit subtraction, you get this. So, you see that your result is starting with 0, the first one is here. So, you need a normalization step. For that, you have to shift the mantissa left by 3 positions, such that this one will come here, right. So, you need a normalization step here, and the result will be 1 point this, and because you have shifted it by 3 positions, your 2 to the power 8 will become 2 to the power 5. So, this adjustment is required at the end, right. So, this is the process of addition or subtraction of a floating point number. Now, you have seen what are the steps that are involved. From this understanding, you can directly generate the circuit that will be required to carry out this process, because you have already seen the steps involved, right. So, you look at this schematic. So, these are the two numbers. This is the first number, this is the second number, sine, exponent, fraction, sine, exponent, fraction. First, what you do, this is a small ALU, this is an 8 bit ALU, this is actually subtracting the two exponents and finding out which one is smaller, and also it is calculating the exponent difference, because later on you will have to shift the mantissa by that amount. So, there is a control circuit here, so I am showing it as a control. So, this information is going to the control. Depending on which exponent is smaller, there is another ALU, where the smaller of the exponents will be coming to the first input. There is a multiplexer here. So, either this fraction or this fraction will be selected, control will be generating the signal. So, that will be shifted right by so many positions, exponent difference. So, after shifting, you do the actual addition or subtraction. These two multiplexers are selected by the control unit. So, after you do the addition or subtraction, again similarly, you will have to look at the process of normalization. Like in the previous example, you have seen that the result was not normalized, you had to shift it left by 3 positions. So, you do the same thing, you may have to shift it, and you see by how many positions you have to shift. So, accordingly you make the adjustment, and for IEEE format, you need an additional step for rounding. So, if you have enabled rounding, so after everything is done, the mantissa will be rounded depending on those two bits R and S, right, and you get the final result, sine, exponent and fraction. So, the concept of floating point addition subtraction is very simple, because already you have seen the steps involved. You have to compare the exponents, you have to align the mantissa by shifting one of them, then you have to do addition or subtraction, then you have to carry out a normalization of the result, and finally, if required, rounding. Okay. So, this is what I have shown you, this is the hardware required for floating point addition and subtraction. Next, let us come to multiplication. Well, for floating point, multiplication and division are relatively easier in concept, because it involves less number of steps. Suppose I am trying to multiply two numbers like this, m 1 2 to the power e 1, m 2 2 to the power e 2. You see, in decimal, let us say in decimal, Suppose I have a number 1.2 into 10 to the power 5, and there is another number, let us say, this is also 1.2 into 10 to the power 6. So, when you multiply two numbers, there is no question of doing any adjustment, mantissa alignment and so on. You simply multiply the two mantissas, 1.2 plus into 1.2 will become 1.44, and you simply add the two exponents, it will be 11. This will be the result, right. But in floating point number, one thing you have to remember that this E1 and E2 that these numbers are having, these are all biased. That means, for single precision number already you have done a plus 127. So, for multiplication, when you are adding these two numbers, so whatever you get, do not forget to subtract a 127 after that, because you have counted 127 twice and the result is having this 127 counted twice. So, you have to subtract it once, so that whatever is the result here, let us say E, the final value of E, that remains normalized. Okay? Fine. So, exactly what I have mentioned is written here. You add the two exponents and subtract the bias, that is 127. Multiply M1 and M2 and also determine the sign of the result, and only at the end you need to normalize the result if it is required. So, it is much simpler than addition, right. So, let us take an example. Suppose we want to multiply 270.75, which in binary is this, and F2 is minus 2.375 minus it is this, both are normalized. So, you add the exponent. See, here we are not showing the value of E in biased form. So, we are not subtracting 127 here. Here what 8 and 1 I am showing is actually EXP, okay? Just for the sake of this example. So, we are adding, but in practice we will be subtracting 127 after adding, right. Then multiply the two mantissas, this and this. If you multiply, the result becomes this. So, which is already normalized, one, it starts with a 1. So, the final result will be this into 2.9, but one thing I am not shown here, you have to take care of the sign separately. You will have to see that one number is positive, other is negative, and you are multiplying. So, the result will be negative, okay? That I have not shown here. So, your multiplier hardware will be conceptually simpler. Like you see, you have the first number here, the second number here. There is an adder which will be adding E1 and E2. You will have to add the two exponents, and these are 8 bit numbers. Temporarily you generate an 9 bit sum. Why? Because you will have to subtract the bias. 127 means all 1. So, after subtracting the bias, you get the final 8 bit result, which is the final exponent. And on the other side, you have a 24 by 24 multiplier, because these mantissas are all 23 bit numbers, right, 23 and 23, but there is an implied 1 bit which is hidden. So, the multiplier will also have to be fed with that extra 1 bit, and then the two numbers multiplied. So, you get a 48 bit product. You look at the product whether it starts with 1 or not. If not, you will have to do a normalization, shift it, and also adjust the exponent accordingly. After that, the final exponent will go into the result, the final mantissa, the 23 bits will go into here, and the sign will be the exclusive OR of S1 and S2. XOR means if it is 0, 1 or 1, 0, then only it will be 1. So, if one of the numbers is positive and other is negative, then only the result will be negative. Otherwise, if both are positive 0 0 or both are negative 1 1, the sign of the result will be positive 0. Okay? So, this is your multiplication hardware in floating point. Division is quite similar. So, for division, let us say I have two numbers similar, m 1 to the power e 1 and m 2 to the e 2. for division, instead of adding the exponents, we are subtracting the exponents. But you see, in both the exponents, we have added a bias. So, when you subtract them, so the bias also gets cancels out. So, you will have to additionally add that bias after the subtraction. Then you divide m1 and m2 and finally normalize. So, let us take an example. Suppose I want to divide this number by this number. So, again f1 in binary normalized form is this, f2 in binary normalized form is this. So, you will have to subtract the exponents for division, 8 minus 1. So, in reality after subtraction you will have to do a plus 127. Then you divide the two mantissas. So, if you carry out division, you will see that the result will be this. So, the result will be, this is the mantissa multiplied by 2 to the power 7, but the result is not normalized, okay? It does not start with a 1. So, you will have to shift it left by one position. So, the point comes here and you will have to adjust the exponent, make it 2 to the power 6. This will be the final result, right. So, the hardware will be very similar to multiplication. So, the only difference is that here instead of addition, you do a subtraction. You subtract the two exponents, you get a 9 bit result and you add the bias to get the final value of the exponent. Similarly, you have a 24 bit divider, this 23 bit mantissas are coming and the implied 1 bits are here. So, you get a divider, divider will be generating the bits of the result. So, again you may have to normalize as the previous example showed, and after normalization you take the corrected value of exponent, the first 23 bits of the result will go to mantissa. And just like multiplication, for division also you take the XOR of the S1 and S2, that will give you the sign of the result, right. This is how division works. Now, for MIPS 32 instructions architecture, there are also floating point arithmetic and floating point provisions there. So, which we have not talked about earlier. Very briefly, let us look at what are the features that are available in MIPS. The first thing is that in the MIPS architecture, we have some floating point registers called F0 up to F31. Just like for integer registers, we had R0 to R31, we have 32 bit floating point registers F0 to F31. Okay. So, these registers are all capable of storing a single precision number because they are 32 bit numbers. Now, additionally, you can also operate on double precision numbers which are 64 bits in size, but when you do it, you will be actually using register pairs F0, F1, F2, F3. Like say for example, if you are using F0 and F1 together, this will be a 64 bit register. If you look at F2 and F3 together, this will also be a 64 bit register, but when you use it in a program, you just refer to as F0 double precision, you refer to as F2 double precision. So, when you are into double precision, F0 means F0 and the next one, F2 means F2 and the next one, right. So, for double precision, it is implied that even and odd register pairs will be taken. So, exactly that is mentioned here, double precision floating point numbers are stored in even odd pairs of floating point registers. Well, in addition to this, there are some special purpose registers also, but here we are not going into details of them because these are not really required right now. So, what I said that is that there are 32 floating point registers and some special purpose registers. And the instructions that relate to this floating point registers are as follows. There are load and store instructions. I can load a single precision floating point number from memory, or I can also do a load double. So, if you had your load double, let us say F 0, it will load it into F 0 and F 1. Similarly, there is a store word, store double word. Data movement instructions, you can move data from an integer register to a floating point register or vice versa, or into some control registers also. The arithmetic instructions in addition to add, subtract, multiply, divide, there are something, some other also. Like you can calculate the absolute value of a number, you can compare two numbers, you can negate, that means given x, you find out minus x, negation of a number, square root of a number, multiply, add, multiply, subtract, means you multiply two numbers and add a third number, a into b plus c. This multiply accumulate kind of instructions or multiply subtract, these are quite useful in various DSP or you can say digital signal processing applications. There this kind of computations appear quite frequently. So, there are special instructions for those also. There are some instructions to round the numbers. So, here you can specify what kind of rounding you are doing, truncation, ceiling, floor, or just round. So, I mentioned these four types are there. And also you can sometimes you have to convert from single to double precision or vice versa, those instructions are also there. Okay. So, I just take one example, take a simple example of adding a scalar to a vector. Like in C, let us say I have a loop like this, where there are 1000 numbers in an array. This array contains floating point numbers, a vector, and S is a scalar, a single number. So, I want to add this S to all the numbers. Let us assume that the register R 1, this is the integer register, initially points to the last number of the array, that means A 1000, and F 2, F 3, these are all double precision numbers. F 2, F 3 register pair contains this scalar value S, and R 2 register is initialized such that it contains the address of just the word before the first A 1, like it goes from A 1 to A 1000. So, it is just before A 1, that means if I add 8 to R 2, it becomes the address of A 1. Okay. So, let us see how this program looks like. L dot d means load double, and if I use a floating point register, it implies it is a floating point instruction. So, if I write like this, R 1 contains the address of A 1000. So, the first two words are loaded into F 0 and F 1, then I am doing add double, this d means double precision. F 2, that means F 2, F 3 is added to F 0, F 1, result is stored in F 4, F 5. Then I am storing double again back into 0 or 1, same place, that means A 1000 gets updated. Then I am add immediate R 1 minus 8, that means I am subtracting 8 from R 1, so that it now points to A 999. Branch not equal to, we continue looping till R 1 and R 2, R 2 is already pointing to the element before the first element. So, till that is true, it continues. So, it is a very simple example which shows how we can use the floating point registers and instructions. It is quite simple, okay? Just an extension of the integer instructions. So, with this we come to the end of this lecture. So, if you recall, in this lecture we had looked at how we can carry out floating point operations, in particular the addition, subtraction, multiplication and division, and also we had discussed the corresponding hardware requirement, how much hardware or what kind of hardware is required. So, you can see that from the addition division, I mean addition subtraction is one type, multiplication division is another type, the hardwares are somewhat similar, but across them also there are some parts which are common, like normalization. After the operation is over, you may have to normalize, you may have to compare the values of two exponents, subtract two exponents. So, there is something common. Later on we will see that how we can merge the two hardware and try to share some functional blocks between say multiplication and addition. Okay. So, this we shall be seeing later. Thank you.